Hey everyone watching this recording of the Service Design Show Live, as I like to call it, the second edition here on Facebook Live. And this is going to be a live episode around the Service Design Global Conference 2017 that took place in Madrid. And I invited two guests to share their highlights, what they thought about the conference, what were the interesting things, because I wasn't able to actually attend the conference, so I'm looking forward to hearing their stories. One of the guests is already in, and that's Dennis Hamburgers. Welcome, Dennis.
Thank you, Mark.
We're waiting for Andrea. Hopefully, we'll manage we're having some technical issues. Technology is always But let's hope Andrea will manage to join us within a few minutes. Dennis, for the people who don't know who you are, could you just give a 1 minute introduction?
Yeah, my name is Dennis Hamburgers. I work at a design agency in Maastricht called Zuiderlicht. And I work there as a strategic design consultant. I have a little bit of a hybrid background. I started my studies at the TU Delft. I studied technology policy and management, and then went on a 15-year journey through design. I also went to art school after that, and I worked at different design agencies and architecture firms, and at one point stumbled upon service design. Mm-hmm. And, for me, that was a homecoming of
I was. When was that? Do you remember the moment that you got in touch with service design? Is my typical question.
Yeah, I don't know the exact moment, but I was doing a bigger project with a more holistic approach and talking to users and trying to figure out the user journey. And then at some point, I ran into some articles about, okay, this is service design. So I concluded what I was doing, I was looking for. Apparently, people call this service design. And then I found, of course, the keyword to look further.
And then I went further. You know what you had to Google.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Awesome. There are already people watching us, Dennis. So that's okay. That's great. If you're tuned in live at this moment, type in a chat and let us know where you're watching from, because I'm really curious who made it to this live episode. We're planning to do about, well, let's say 30, 40 minutes, depending on how many questions there are. So leave a comment on the Facebook post and let us know where you're watching from. And type in a yes or a no if you actually attended the conference. So I'll say a big hi to everyone in the chat. You can also join in, I think, Dennis, on the chat, just directly on Facebook. And I think Andrea is coming along. Yeah, looking good. I'll add Andrea to the broadcast. There we go. Andrea, hey. You made it.
Are we live?
We are definitely live. So say hi to everyone.
Yeah. Canada, happy- this on my coffee cup or something.
Yeah, we are really small. We are like cut in three pieces. So, Andrea, you're joining from San Francisco right now, right?
Yeah.
Or is it? We're stumbling with the camera.
Yeah, sorry. I'm trying to get it.
I'll continue with saying hi to everyone in the chat. 13 people are watching. So let me see if I can show this comment. Let's hide this and hide this. Too bad. Let's see. Oh, we can do really funny things like this. This is our second Facebook Live event, so we are still figuring out how how everything looks.
Cool.
Andrea, Dennis just gave a 60-second introduction about who he is and what he does. So maybe for the people who don't know who you are, could you briefly introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure. I'm Andrea Feinman, and I work in San Francisco at Adaptive Path, which is the service design group inside Capital One. And so for anyone that doesn't know about Capital One, it's a financial services company mostly based here in the US, but also Canada and the UK. So I'm a service designer and I focus on all kinds of customer and employee experiences and design strategy for all of Capital One's various businesses.
That sounds like a lot.
I'm not the only one here.
Awesome. So I'm sitting at home. Dennis is at home. You're probably at the studio right now. And like I said, I'm encouraging everyone who's watching this, type in, join in on the chat. We'll be asking you a question, guys and girls, because this is live and we would like to interact. I'll try to keep an eye on all the comments that are coming in and forward them to you, to Andrea and Dennis. So my goal of today is to learn a little bit about the highlights of the Service Design Network. Or it's actually the Service Design Global Conference, because I wasn't there and I invited you to, or you two volunteered actually to share your highlights. So I would say let's go over them one by one, and we'll start with you, Dennis, and then move over to Andrea and then sort of bounce it back and forward until we are left out of highlights. How does that sound?
Good.
Yep.
Yeah? So okay. Dennis, it's up to you to kick it off. You know, what was your number one highlight from the conference?
Yeah, let me maybe just start off by saying that what was a wonderful conference in total. It's a big 2-day conference and a lot of talks and a lot of inspirations. And I think what I especially like about the conference, also it's a little bit the end of the year. So it's looking back, like how was last year's service design, and looking forward to what we're going to do next year. And I always find it fascinating how the theme of the conference really links to issues that people are dealing with. And
for the people who don't know what the theme was, it was...
This year it was scaling service design. Yeah. So like last year it was service design is the new normal. So we, like last year was a little bit the conclusion that, okay, service design really... matured, and really a lot of people are enthusiastic about it. There are really big successes with service design projects, so it's becoming the new gold standard for innovation projects. So this year, I think going further on that topic, it was because if then you have success and the big projects get bigger and again more projects, you get a whole different set of problems. You don't have to prove the value of service design anymore, but you run into scaling issues. I think a lot of people, you know.
Yeah, I think at least I see that also in a lot of episodes that I do, that scaling is a big, big topic at this moment.
Yeah, a lot of people talked about it in very different viewpoints. And what I found interesting is that when you talk about scaling, like in the center of service design, everything is going well. People are having successes, having good projects. But the scaling, I found it interesting that it's a little bit about the edges. Is service design getting, to what direction is it scaling? Is it just getting bigger projects, or is it maybe moving a little bit? Mm. Yeah, the definition of service design, of what we should do. And I think one of the first highlights I picked from the conference was also the opening keynote by Louise Down. I think she also was a guest here on the
absolutely.
Show.
Yeah.
And I wrote down a quote she gave, and it's like this. She said, "Service design is not about the ability of a designer to design a service, but about the ability of an organization to deliver that service." So this was also a topic that was around the conference. Like, is service design just about designing? Is it finished after you delivered the service design blueprint?
Yeah.
Or should the service designer also consider himself with the delivery and the process afterwards?
What are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, I'm all in the delivery camp. I think, service design without any delivery is not good service design.
Go ahead.
No, I think because when you scale, and this is one aspect of scaling. You could say, okay, we're doing research and we're doing design, and we could scale into the delivery phase, so we could also own that phase or contribute to it at least.
But are we equipped to? Do you think our architects aren't the construction workers? You know, are we the construction workers too?
Yeah, I think we have to know a little bit about it because funny that you say, because I worked at two different architecture firms and they also had two different approaches to that. One had more of an, okay, the architecture, the designs are finished. Let's give it to the constructors and they're going to build it. And the other architect says, okay, now I made the designs and I'm going to check every day at the construction site if the constructor is building it the way it should have been built. And what I found, like in the projects I do, that a lot of the challenges and a lot of things, like the most and the hardest work is done at the delivery phase. Right? You can make a beautiful design, but once you get into a like agile development process, there's a lot of decisions have to be made. The design has to be adjusted. You have to work with technology, with the business, and yeah, if the design can be a part of that, the quality of the end product will be a lot higher.
So let's just keep the pace up pretty high. The highlight one was, you know, do we have to involve ourselves in the delivery phase? And if so, how and how much, right? That's basically...
Yeah,
I think that's a really big question that we're facing. And I think my first highlight is kind of similar to what Dennis said. I think... Like Mark was saying, not everybody can, or nobody can be the number one most skilled person at every step in the process. And so while service designers are especially known for being able to look across all the touch points and know a little bit about all the different areas, like Dennis is saying, I think there's limits to how much we can be the number one expert in the room about both the strategy and the research and the ability to bring all the touch points together and also then the delivery and all of the different things that entails.
Yeah.
And what I noticed was really the most striking thing to me during the conference was that I felt like the speakers all had really different viewpoints. And I feel like if they had been in a conversation like we're having right now versus giving individual talks, I feel like there might have been a lot of disagreement between the speakers, and specifically in terms of such things as what is service design and what should service designers do.
I thought we had that discussion. We were over that discussion, but it's a whole new thing again.
Yeah, I think with the aspect of scaling, like Dennis is saying, it raises these questions again in terms of how do we do service design and how do we spread it towards all the people in an organization? What elements do we teach and what elements do we specialize in? I think this is another area where teaching and training is a huge part of service design. Probably all of us have been involved in corporate trainings of some sort, either taking them or teaching them, and figuring out, I think that delivering corporate training also is a huge part of how a lot of groups are trying to scale service design. I know we're doing that here where I work. And so that forces you to ask the question, where do we specialize when we're not teaching, or is teaching our whole job?
Right. That's interesting for the people who are all live right now, you know, is teaching our job as service designers? Is that our end role? That's a really interesting take, right?
Yeah, I think teaching is important, and I don't think you could get away with being a service designer and never teaching, or I think it's not a very nice attitude to say you don't want to share or you don't want to teach at all. Yeah. But on the other hand, teaching and designing, I think, are separate vocations. And so you could do half and half or however you want to balance it. There's still an element of designing user, customer, employee experiences, whatever that we do, which is not strictly education.
So maybe it's also, go ahead, Dennis.
What I find interesting for maybe a question for Andrea is because she's working at a very large service design agency. And if this is different, because service design in my view, especially when you're working at a smaller agency, it's very holistic. Huh? You say you cannot be the best at this, that, and that, but if you're in a small team, you have to be a little bit more holistic, and the more holistic you are, the better the end quality maybe is. But maybe you're working at a bigger agency, and I can imagine that the service designers are more specialized in your
agency. I think that's definitely part of it. And I think the way that my group works is a lot more like an in-house team than an agency. And so there's hundreds of people that work at Capital One who are really talented at doing UX, doing user research, designing UIs. There's like in my group, there's no developers. And so throughout Capital One, there's tons of really talented front-end developers. It would be kind of silly if we kind of came in from San Francisco and we were like, oh, we're here to tell you about front-end development and how it works. Like, yeah, I know a little bit about that, but I would never be able to go get a job in Capital One HQ as a front-end developer because I don't have those kinds of skills. So I think that's an area where we offer what we have to offer, but we, to some extent, we stay out of telling other people how to do their job when it comes to other aspects, other crafts of design.
Yeah, it's funny how you put it, because telling people, I think when in my experience, when it's a more agile setting, it's not about telling people what to do, but if you're a little bit more T-shaped, just cooperating and co-creating, then I think it helps when you know a little bit about development to also speak the language of the developers, talk to them, maybe help them find better solutions, and also find a solution between development, design, and technology.
Yeah, that's totally true. I think in a company with 50,000 employees, you'll never have a workshop that has a developer and a process engineer and an employee training person and all the different people that you need to affect every touch point in the customer journey.
Right. You know, guys, this you're not going to make this into a regular service design show episode. We're going to talk about the conference. Let's get back to the conference,
okay,
guys. We've got some new guests who joined in, saying hi to everyone who's watching live. Thanks for joining the service design show, and Andrea and Dennis and me. Again, feel free to join in on the chat. Type in a yes or a no if you've been to the conference. Let us know where you're watching from. That would be really awesome. Dennis, go ahead. Number two, highlight number two.
Number two was also a quote from a woman called Xenia Validas. I hope I pronounced that right. She said, the key skill of a service designer is his ability to zoom out. You should own the overarching perspective for maximum impact and relevance. I think it also connects to what we're talking about. And it's one of the extremes, maybe. When somebody says, okay, maybe there will be specializations in service design, this woman was saying, okay, service design is already holistic, but we need to zoom out even further to add more value.
How would it look? Did she point to some scenarios?
No, she didn't. But what I found interesting, like from a zooming out perspective, there was, I think that were only there were two people from the BBVA, the financial institution, on stage with Birgit Magers. They were doing a talk with the three of them, and they said they have a chief design officer, and he said for all innovations projects, we have to have technology, design, and business on a team. Otherwise, you cannot start with a project. And I think the zooming out for me also has to do with this. Huh? So you have a bigger view of the elements that are involved. So you also take a look at the technology part, you take a look at the business part. And another someone who was talking about zooming out was saying something along the lines of we shouldn't design just the services, but the whole, we should focus on the ecosystem. So this is also a level of zooming out that you could connect to the quote from Xenia.
Anything to add to that or to connect to that, Andrea? Did you recognize the pattern?
Yeah, I really like Xenia's talk. I think part of what Xenia was getting at was, so Xenia is a professor at SCAD, and so she teaches students, like college students and graduate students, in the service design major there. And I think she probably does a lot of thinking about what is service design, how is it differentiated, what does it mean to be a service designer versus UX designer and stuff like that. And I feel like what she was getting, this is my interpretation, what she's getting at was about that specialization aspect or just differentiate. It's kind of a paradox, right? Differentiating service designers as people that are looking after the overarching experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe it's also a question. What was you trying to ask a question in the beginning? Yeah, maybe also to the audience, huh? Because this moving into the delivery, taking the business design and technology perspective, looking at ecosystems instead of just services. And like, maybe this is a nice question for the audience that you posted in the beginning. Like, do the service designers have the skills to do that? Huh? Do we, if we want to scale it up like this, are the service designers equipped to do this or not?
And then scale up in the sense of zooming out, you mean? Are we able to design ecosystems?
Exactly, because then it gets even more complex.
Designing services are hard enough already.
Yeah, it's already complex, but should we make it even more complex? And does this add value? And can we do it if we wanted to? Mm.
So everyone watching, you know, do you think service designers have the capabilities, or if they don't, which capabilities would we need to actually zoom out even more and design even bigger things? I think the videos from the conference will be online really soon. So Xenia's talk, check it out, right? Pedro, highlight number two for you.
Yeah, so the second thing that I wanted to talk about is this idea of systems thinking or designing for systems. I think that has to do with your question. I'm kind of new to this topic, and I don't know how this would work. But in terms of what skills do people need or what attitude do people need to take if they're going to focus on the ecosystem or the overarching aspect of the experience, I think there might be some answers for us in the world of systems. I don't even know if systems thinking is the right way to phrase it, but there was a whole track during the conference, like a side track of speakers about systems. And I thought it was really great. The room was packed. All the people that spoke were really good. There was one woman, I think from the Northern Ireland government, and she comes from a field called systems dynamics, I think. And she had so many interesting, and she, I would say maybe she doesn't come from a design discipline or a design background, but she's worked in a field like service design where for 50 years, people in the outside world don't necessarily know what that is. They haven't, it's not like being a doctor or something where people know instantly what that is. And they've had their own kind of identity crises over the years in terms of trying to spread their ideas to the outside world and then feeling nervous about whether they're really making the right impact or really getting through to people what they're getting at when they're trying to spread their ideas. But she introduced some concepts from a lot of different disciplines in science and statistics and politics about how to plan for evolving ecosystems, which I feel like is a huge thing right now. So this is my question to Dennis and you and to the audience, how we can kind of get into this and learn more in an appropriate way.
And could you specify this?
Systems thinking, systems design, this whole discipline of understanding systems that has grown up in the 20th century outside of design.
Because we've borrowed a lot of tools and methods from sociology, anthropology, all that kind of stuff. What can we borrow from the systems thinking field, right?
Yeah.
What do they have to offer for us?
Yeah, that's really interesting.
Yeah, it's funny thing. Yeah, because the I was telling in the introduction what I studied in Delft. When I studied there, the education was called Systems Engineering Policy Analysis and Management.
There you go.
A whole there was a whole like one third of the education was about systems engineering, and what we did there was to use, because systems typically cannot be deducted fully. Yeah? You cannot break it into parts because there's so many interactions between all the parties in the system that you cannot know how the system would react. So what we did there, for instance, is a lot of simulations about systems. So we had to program all the elements and all their interactions, and you try to put in a measure, or you put in a variable, and you see how it works. So you see from the reaction of the system how this works. And what I find interesting with when you see also like a system, an organization as a system, where you come in with your service design, that also this design is also a force in the system that changes things. Huh? It changes people, it changes relations, it changes interactions. And for me, this like this ripple effect of the design that you bring in, for me is the most interesting part about design and service design, that you, yeah, they create a platform for people to come together. You create new mindsets. So you are actually creating a new force into the system that the organization is. Mm.
Susanna just shared an interesting link in the chat. Link to Thinking in Systems is a nice introduction. Thanks for that, Susanna. I think there's so much we still can learn and can benefit from fields like this, who, like you said, Andrea, have been thinking about this for quite a long time, and now we're coming in and trying to figure out how it all works, right? Who, do you still remember who was this? A public presentation? Do you think the video will be online, or was this a breakout session?
I'm sure they were filming it. I mean, I can't say with certainty that she was able to give the rights to publish the video to the conference, but her name was Sarah Wiley.
Sarah,
and she was from
Wiley.
Northern Ireland.
All right. Was that your second highlight? So the how do we integrate system thinking into the practice of service design?
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on, Dennis.
Yeah, I think it can make a nice bridge to my third highlight, because if we're moving into different fields like systems engineering and other things, also technology, like the third thing I found, this was maybe zooming out even a level bigger. There were two quotes that I found interesting. One by Mikko Koivisto. He said that we should step out of the design bubble. And related to that, there was a woman called Sarah Drummond. She said, don't be the agency. So for me, that was...
What did she mean?
Yeah, I don't... what she meant was, I think, how I interpreted it, was that you don't... like, you should blend more with the... It should be more of a partnership with the organization you're working with. It's not like you're an agency and you have a certain approach and certain tools and you have to do it like this, but you should, work in the reality of the organization, like the best practices, the people that are there. This is the medium, let's say, you have to work with as a service designer. And I think this also relates to this design bubble idea. You should step over the boundaries, and even I think Andrea also said it in the beginning, maybe you shouldn't even call it service design what you're doing, just help the organization move ahead and not confuse them with all kinds of terms like service design, design thinking, business design. Just try to solve business problems for them within the situation that's at hand.
And how did Sarah small scoop for the people who are watching, Sarah will be a future guest on the show coming really soon, so I can ask her questions we have. But if it's not the agency and it's more of a partnership, how does that look in practice? Did she give some, again, scenarios, paint a picture how the future agency might look?
No, I don't think she did that. She just pointed to obstacles if you don't do it. Mm. If you that it's for an organization who wants to hire service designers, they don't want to hire in a couple of people who come in with their way of doing and totally do not match with the organization that's there, and it can be really, really annoying. And like they have an idea, they heard about service design, they think it's a good idea, but then a service design agency comes in with an arrogant attitude maybe, and with their own ways of doing, and they don't take into consideration the reality of the business, and then it just is a mismatch. And I think this is a problem.
Yeah. I guess this also has to deal with thinking of service design in terms of projects versus thinking of service design in terms of a department or organizational skill. What do you think about that, Andrea?
Yeah, I think everything that Dennis is saying really – so I don't work with Sarah Drummond, but everything Dennis is saying about her talk really reflects the way that my group works. So we really we try really hard not to seem like an outside agency. We try to be as integrated as we can, which is a challenge because the company has two headquarters and neither of them is in the same city where we live. So that's a challenge. But the idea of coming in and trying to understand the business and then not just dropping off when the project ends and saying, well, okay, see you never, like you figure out how to build this. Instead, we're staying linked with them. And we think of it, some of our projects are pretty cut and dried, and then there's a little bit of continuing work. But some of them are more like programs where there's no, there may be phases, but there's no definitive goal that we reach the end of, and then the other people are on their own.
Yeah. You're working towards customer centricity or employee experience, and that's a never-ending process, right?
Yeah, and I think the company is actually really, really focused on doing the right thing for customers, and I think it with any one decision in the moment, I think people throughout Capital One are really good at making the right decision, but I think it's the overarching strategy about how the service works for customers and for the business and for the people that work here, that's the lens that we bring.
Andrea, what was your third highlight?
So I saw a talk at the Members Day by a woman named Marcia Arrico, and she works at LiveWork. I think she's the head of insights. I'm not sure. Maybe that's like head of research or something. I'm not sure. But she gave a really, really good talk. It was pretty short. It was really concise. I felt like she had done a bunch of research and synthesized it into some really good points. And then she just delivered them like, here you go. And everyone was just eating it up. So one of her things that she presented to us based off all the research that she's done into trends about the industry is that she thinks that in the future, service designers will specialize in four areas. And I don't think she was saying that you have to choose one or, you know, you have to do these four or you're out or something. But the four areas of specialty that she saw service designers kind of filtering into were number one, relationship designers. I think that has to do with in-person or interpersonal interactions, whether they're with humans or with bots or something. The next one was behavior design, which I think is easy to understand. Behavioral economics.
Andrea, your connection broke off or mined it for the last 30 seconds. So I cut you off in the cliffhanger where you were saying the four topics you broke. So could you start from there?
The first one was relationship designer. And so I think she meant designing interactions both between humans and between humans and bots and things like that. The second one was behavior designer. So I think that one's pretty easy to understand because behavioral change and behavioral economics as an idea has been really huge in service design and UX and product design for a long time. The third one was visualizer. So I think what she meant by that was helping organizations by mapping and showing what's going on in the organization and what's going on in the ecosystem, which is a huge thing that service designers all do today. And then the last one was translator. And I think what she meant by that was kind of like a data translator, like someone who can translate research or facts or data within the organization, more of a like a technical-minded person who can help translate between engineers and business people and software people and people that do employee training and all the different groups of people in the organization who have their own languages and their own expertise and specialties.
So what was this a highlight for you? What did you enjoy this talk?
I felt like it was a really, you don't always see that often, someone presenting research about trends or predictions that are presented with such good data and confidence that to where you say, you know, this person really put in the research and it really shows. And I feel really confident that what she has to say is true. And I felt like the four areas of focus that she mentioned were, they just really resonated with me. That's not to say, oh, I can see myself doing all four roles personally, but I felt like she had really hit upon four areas that are really popular or big in our discipline, but we don't always think of them as distinct,
she articulated
things.
Them pretty well.
Yeah.
Cool.
So my question to the audience is, of those four roles, relationship designer, behavior designer, visualizer, and translator, where do people see themselves fitting in? Or like, if you were going to specialize in one in your organization, like what seems most natural to you?
So yeah, come on guys, in the chat, a lot of people are watching actually. So that's pretty cool. Are you a visualizer, relationship builder, translator, and the fourth one?
Behavioral.
Was? Behavioral yeah. designer. So everybody in the chat, leave a comment, guys. Dennis, I know that we haven't talked about this yet, but you also presented during the conference, right?
Yes, yes.
I saw that you posted the Medium post. Was this about your presentation?
No, this was not about my presentation. I posted my presentation. I posted it on SlideShare, but
Feel free to post the link on the thread here on Facebook. But could you give us like a super short recap of your presentation?
Yeah, I think the main message of our presentation in relation to scaling service design is that we talked about how much the little things matter. Like we said, like service design as a craft might seem easy. You can explain to anybody in 5 to 10 minutes how to make a stakeholder map or draw a customer journey or all these tools that we use seem very easy. But we try to stress the little things that make or break service design projects. Huh? If you want
give
to
us one example.
One example was we talked about, for instance, stakeholder map. We said we found I did the presentation together with a client I worked with from the Maastricht University, and we once came in with the two of us came into a project, and we thought it was a good idea to draw a stakeholder map to get an idea of all the stakeholders, but to also to introduce into this project the visualization and co-creation aspects of service design. So we started to draw the map, and we explained how it worked, and we planned a couple of workshops, but we ended up just discussing all the details of all the stakeholders, ways to draw the map, and we didn't really, there were no insights created, there were no creative ideas, and so in the end, we did three workshops, but it was the result was no bigger than if we would just have a simple list of all the stakeholders. So just to point that that although it might seem an easy tool, it doesn't always lead to the results you want.
And your presentation, if people want to know more about your presentation, it is on SlideShare, right? People
yes.
can watch it and I probably will see the recording. After we're done with the broadcast, type in the link on type it in as a comment so people can find it. There was one question in the chat actually for you, Andrea, and that's from Rachel, and she's saying, could you say a bit more about the difference between relationship and behavioral designers? What did?
Yeah. Well, to be clear, it's not my idea. It was Marzia's idea, so I don't want to take credit for it. But I think the idea about relationship design was, I think maybe content strategy and employee training and employee experience are some areas that fall into that. Designing the way that customers interact with employees, or designing the way that you interact with Siri or a chatbot or something. That was an area of focus that she had. And then the other one was behavioral design, which would be like gamifying your Fitbit or something to help you lose weight, or changing behaviors inside an organization so that people can work together more easily. Or I hope Marzia is not listening, and those are good examples.
Well, if she is, I hope she is. She will join on the chat. I hope this helps, Rachel. What are you hoping for the conference for next year? What do you hope, Andrea? What do you hope to see next year?
Next year. So one thing that I'm really interested in is data and how data can be used to design services that are kind of like living services, is how they talk about it at Fjord. Services that are always adjusting, that can be personalized. I think there's a way for service designers to design principles or guidelines or kind of the texture of a service, and then have technology actually carry it out and adjust it in different ways. But I don't know how to do that yet. It's kind of like, oh, of course we could do that, but if only someone could figure out how and write a case study.
I think
that's something that I'm really interested in, and I hope to see. I feel like it's really hard to even have the vocabulary around this topic, and I'm always asking people about it, and I feel like I'm not always getting through what I even mean when I'm trying to ask someone else. So this is
maybe
an area that I think needs development.
Visualize it.
I know. I need a storyboard.
Who knows? Dennis, what are you hoping for next year?
What I found interesting is in the triangle I talked about between the business design and technology, to see how business or service design gets more integrated into the organizations. Like it's not just a separate department, but how the integration works. I heard this year at the conference a lot of big organizations are recruiting a lot of designers and creating in-house design teams. But between the lines, you hear that it's still, designers are still in a hostile environment, that not everybody receives them with open arms, and they're not, it's not really integrated yet. And I think one of the movements is that you see that people are putting a lot of effort into this integration, and I would be keen to see how this works.
Different organizational forms of integrating design, right?
Yes, it's also about the scaling in different directions of service design within organizations, and if it can get to the level of decision making, about policy making, these kind of things.
Well, was there a theme announced for next year? I don't think so yet, right?
Okay.
So we'll keep an eye on that. And maybe if there are out, there will be definitely a Service Design Show episode on that. So we've been in for 45 minutes. Thanks, Andrea. Thanks, Dennis. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Everyone who's watching, I hope you enjoyed it too. This was the second live episode. I think I'll do a few more if people start to joining us like today. Final words. If you haven't checked it out, of course, go to the YouTube channel, servicedesignshow.com/YouTube or YouTube.com/servicedesignshow. check out some of the past episodes. A few of the people who were mentioned in this live broadcast were also guests on the show. Andrea was a guest about the Service Experience Conference. Louise Downey had a great talk, had a great episode. So check it out, servicedesignshow.com/YouTube. And also about, if you're interested in integrating business and design, there's a course out there. I've not been yet promoting it that much, but it's called Selling Service Design with Confidence. And it's really about how do you communicate and articulate the value of service design in terms that business people understand. So if you're interested in that course, check out learn.servicedesignshow.com. I'll post a link in the comments. Thanks again, Dennis. Thanks again, Andrea. I hope to be at the conference next year. Maybe we'll meet face-to-face. It would be much better.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
Have a great day, everybody.
Hey, bye-bye.
See ya. And here's the button to end the broadcast.